Namaskar. Today we shall talk about environment and ecology. We all know that there is a degradation of environment. In this lecture, we are not going to talk about the causes of degradation, but our concern here is in what way the Jain principles and practices help prevent degradation. Environmental protection is intrinsic, innate and inherent in Jainism. It is inbuilt and integrated in every principle, tenet and mandatory doctrine of Jainism, in its epistemology, ontology and metaphysical concepts. The connotation about environment is much wider than generally understood. It implies not only physical environment of air, water, soil, animals, etc., but also social environment of multitudinous relationships between individual human beings, families, groups, societies, and nations, and also interdependent interactions between all life forms, which also interact with physical constituents. So we are taking a generalized idea of environment, including the physical environment as well as social environment. Both physical and social environments are interactive, mutually reinforcing and influencing to mold and condition each other. So, both of them must be considered in order to have a comprehensive view of environmental problems. If physical or natural environment suffered degradation, pollution and imbalance, the consequences in greenhouse effect, climate change, droughts, floods, storms, famines, pestilences, etc., will influence and disturb the social environment, you know, and its stability, health and harmony. So, the degradation in one affects the another and vice versa. Likewise, imbalances in social environment beset with conflicts and wars will adversely affect the physical environment, accentuating its degradation, pollution and imbalances, and this in turn will disturb the social environment and the vicious cycle will go on. So, because both kinds of environments are interlinked and interdependent, obviously one affects the other. Environment should be considered in its totality as a composite aggregate whole in which every constituent, small and big, is equally important in its own specific symbiotic role. So, we are not saying, you know, which is a bigger problem, which is a smaller problem. Disregarding this kind of attitude, you know, both are equal as far as our environment is concerned. Only mankind is responsible for environmental degradation. This is a point to be noted, you know. Other life forms live symbiotically and in harmony with nature. So, whatever degradation is taking place, it's the human beings are responsible. Animals are not responsible. The single most important main cause of all problems is attachment or infatuation or lust or greed for hedonistic sensual pleasures named rag and its attendant simultaneous inseparable antithesis, dvesh or aversion. So, these tendencies of human beings in the form of attachment and aversion. And we are attached to many things, you know, attached to other fellow citizens, and not only that, we are attached to material objects, we are attached to even animals many times, and so on. And then we also have aversion, you know, we have a displeasure with our fellow beings, with even material objects or animals, and so on. So these two attributes, attachment and aversion, you know, and we are not free of these two, everyone is having them in to some extent, as somebody has more and somebody has less, but nevertheless they are there. And these are the principal causes of the environmental problems. Under the influence of these psychic impulses, individuals, families, groups, societies, nations commit violence, indulge in sensual pleasures, unbridled consumerism, and madness for suicidal development. So all these things which are happening in the world is because of these two main attributes, you know, attachment and aversion. And the term, note the term used here, suicidal development. You know. Development is good, but the development which we are planning of and thinking of and having is suicidal, because it is adversely affecting our environment. The very index of development prescribed by modern economists is higher and higher level of consumption. So this has become the scale of development, you know, that if you consume higher things or your consumption rate is high, you are better off. And this is not true. This is not the real reality, you know. They are blind to crass realities that it is consumerism that is most damaging to environment, you know. So if you consume more things, you damage the environment to a greater extent. I'll briefly present to you the environmental scenario. Biodiversity is the most important component of environment. It boosts ecosystem productivity, where each species, no matter how small, all have an important role to play. And Jainism gives equal importance to all life forms, remember. It is feared that human activity is causing massive extinctions. Many species have become extinct, you know. And you look at the figures, you know, you can find the figures on Google, and you'll find that this is very sad picture. Forests, various from various animal species, forests and the ecosystem, the forest support and marine life, all these life forms are going into extinction, you know, because of human activity, because of human desire, because of human lust. The World Resources Institute reports that there is a link between biodiversity and climate change. Rapid global warming can affect ecosystems' chances to adapt naturally. Our ecosystem normally is such, you know, that it can naturally adapt to a certain rate of consumption. But if your consumption rate is higher than that, then, you know, there are side effects and adverse effects in form of global warming, climate change, and so on. Many are agreed that climate change may be one of the greatest threats facing the planet. Recent years show increasing temperatures in various regions and or increasing extremities in weather patterns, you know, and we can see that very clearly nowadays. The United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change was signed by over 150 countries at the Rio Earth Summit in 1992. The United States plus a few other countries and many large corporations have been against climate change treaties due to the fear of the threat to their economy and profits. So look here how the selfish are some countries, you know. They look to their own interest and not the global interest, you know. So they give priority to their own good rather than the good of everyone or good of the Earth planet. When the world's majority countries signed up to climate change convention, including countries like US, who would later withdraw from the subsequent Kyoto Protocol, it was agreed that it is today's rich nations who are the ones responsible for global warming. So this is an important point to note, you know, the global warming which we are facing today, the responsibility lies more on the rich nations rather than the poor nations. When considering that globally, the 20% of the world's people in the highest income countries account for 86% of total private consumption expenditures. So look here at this alarming figure. 20% of the world population is consuming 86% of the resources. And the poorest 20%, a minuscule 1.3%, the rest 20% consume such a less part of resources. According to the United Nations Development Program, 1998 Human Development Report, you know. This is the information which is coming from the United Nations. Environmental degradation can contribute to social and political instability, which can lead to security issues, you know. So the environmental degradation is very closely linked to all these social and political issues and systems, and ultimately to the security issues. Now, with this scenario, what we are discussing is in what way the principles of Zen philosophy help us, you know, in preserving the environment and preventing the degradation. So I'll take one by one the all relevant doctrines of Zen philosophy and see how they help us. The first is doctrine of equality. Jainism stands unique in assigning equal status, same as of a human being, to all constituents of environment. The main constituents, most important, life-supporting natural resources, earth means soil and minerals, water, energy means fire, air and plants, are as much living beings as human beings and should be considered and treated as such. So as you respect human beings, so also and in the same way one must respect other living forms, including the earth life, the water life, the air life and so on. This will eliminate possibility of harm to them. If you have this kind of view, you will not harm them. Human beings must not encroach and exploit anyone beyond its capacity. Jainism does not deny that you should not use these resources. This is our requirement and our demand that we use the natural resources for our life. But you must use them to their carrying capacity and not beyond. There will not be destruction of anyone, you know. So if you do, if you limit yourself to that pattern of consumption or utilization of natural resources, you are not destructing the environment. So this is one doctrine, that you give equal status to all life forms. The second doctrine says the doctrine of non-violence, very important. What is non-violence? While killing is an extreme form of violence and is being committed on slightest pretexts, other common forms of violence are generally ignored and not even considered violence, you know. And this we did discuss in one of the lectures. The doctrine of non-violence prohibits occupations, professions and business which involves violence to various forms of living beings and which are harmful for environment. So, Jainism adjoins on its followers that look here, don't take any occupation or profession or business where the violence is involved. So, one must choose a profession or occupation where the violence is minimum, or you must try to find ways to minimize violence in these professions and occupations and business. The Jain doctrine of non-violence addresses all aspects of protection, preservation and sustainability of environment. Number one, socio-political argument against violence. Observation of total non-violence so that armament race discontinues and comes to a stop. So, this is the first thing to note, you know. Today, the maximum expenditure and the maximum resources are being utilized for defense purpose, armament race, you know. So, you have the concept of non-violence and stop this armament race and discontinue the arms which you have, you know, whether they are nuclear arms or otherwise. Psychological argument against violence. Human suffering caused by theft, holding, falsehood, slavery, economic exploitation, social oppression, curtailment of legitimate freedoms and the like, which is a great mental disturbance, is dreadful and is associated with unbearable pain and affliction. So, all these forms, all these practices, you know, of which I have just now mentioned, you know, theft, holding, etc., they cause great social pain, personal pain and affliction, and must be avoided. Like one's own existence, it recognizes the existence of other beings, you know. So, it's not you or me, it is you and me, you know, that concept. For a healthy living, it includes all the values directed to the other, without overemphasizing the values directed to one's own self, you know. So, you must always have in mind consideration of others along with your own interest. Some people argue that religion is the primary source of violence, or violence has always played an important part in history of religions, you know. Yes, history is like that, you know, but that does not mean that any religion is bad. Every spiritual belief decries violence, you know. No religion, in fact, advocates for violence, you know. This is an important point to note. It is only the misguided individuals who see no wrong in adopting violent means to advance their beliefs and religion, you know. So, this is a misguided belief, you know, which is working in the minds of the people, and they want to expand their own religion even at the cost of conflicts and force. Never before there has been a need so strong for non-violence as in today's atomic age, you know. So today we need non-violence very urgently, in fact, you know, and very serious attempts must be made because we live in atomic age, you know, and what atomic arms and atomic nuclear arms can do to human beings, we know from our history. Non-violence at this juncture is the only sound, logical and cogent remedy for the ills afflicting our age. So, non-violence is the only hope in this violent world today. Then the next one is a doctrine of truth. It also helps, you know, in preserving the environment. How? Truth is generally understood in a very restricted sense of not indulging in falsehood or not speaking a lie. But truth has much wider meaning. It is commitment for right and rational and stand against all that is wrong, violent and superstitious. Truth is important concomitant for non-violence. So not only that we ourselves practice the doctrine of truth, we don't tell lie or don't indulge in practices, you know, which involve this, but one should go forward and stand for what is right and what is rational and stand against all that is wrong, you know, that is also part of truth. So this is very important, and we must come forward and take serious note of this. While telling truth, views of others should also be respected to avoid rifts between different persons, groups, societies, communities and religions. This aspect we talked about earlier also. Then doctrine of non-stealing. Normally, you know, non-stealing, we mean that, you know, we don't steal other persons' belongings or properties. So, we restrict ourselves to relations between human beings. Now, here it is very different. The vow of non-stealing also reinforces the vow of non-violence. Non-stealing should not be limited between human beings only. It does apply in respect of other beings, other living beings also. One should not take, snatch or usurp possessions and conveniences of any other life form. The other life forms, animals and so on, they are speechless, you know, they cannot speak. But they also have a right on the resources, you know. And you are stealing the resources which are meant for them. So, natural resources, soil, water, air, plant are also living beings, and their exploitation beyond their carrying capacity is therefore also stealing, you know. This amounts to stealing. This is a very powerful statement that, you know, if you are doing this, you are actually stealing. We should compensate nature to the extent we take from it. Such as planting trees, keeping water resources and air clean, free from pollution. So this is our responsibility. If you are polluting air, if you are polluting water, you are actually killing those life forms which are there in air, water, earth and so on. This is violence. This doctrine of non-stealing is therefore important for environmental health, you know. So, if you have this in mind, you are protecting the environment. An important way of doing the protection. The doctrine of non-consumerism. With increasing industrialization and made race for economic development, consumerism is rising as the very definition and index of development is a higher and higher per capita consumption, you know. This definite itself is damaging the environment, you know. The consumption cannot be a scale for your prosperity. Any increase in consumption puts more and more pressure on natural resources, obviously, which are being exploited beyond their carrying capacity. damaging, degrading, and even completely exhausting many of the shrinking resources, you know. Presently, consumerism is the most damaging cause of environmental degradation, and this must be discouraged with all our might. According to William Rees of the University of British Columbia, human society is in a global overshoot, consuming 30% more material than is sustainable from the world's resources. Look here, you have to reduce your consumption level by 30% in order that, you know, the natural resources become self-sustained, or you have a self-sustained development. We are beginning to get just a hint of how wasteful the wealthier societies are. United Nations Human Development Report 1998 reflects the following figures. This is very interesting. You look at what are the levels of consumption in different societies. So here we have a global priority and consumption in US dollar billions of dollars. Cosmetics in United States, consumption level $8 billion. Ice cream in Europe $11 billion. Perfumes in Europe and US $12 million. Pet foods in Europe and US $17 million. Business entertainment in Japan $35 million. Cigarettes in Europe $50 million. Alcoholic drinks in Europe $105 million. Narcotic drugs in the world $400 million. Military spending in the world $780 million. You know, so we are spending our resources, a major chunk of our resources, on military spend. The estimated additional cost to achieve universal access to basic social services in all developed countries. This is on a very astonishing example. If you want to have a basic education for all in the world, you need only $6 billion. Look here, the meager amount which you need for all these social services in comparison to what you have been doing otherwise. Water and sanitation for all, only $9 billion. Reproductive health for all women, $12 billion. Basic health and nutrition, $13 billion. So even if you reduce your consumption pattern, you know, by a small amount, you can help the world in many ways. An effective solution to these problems lies in imposing self-restraint and observing the recommendations of Zen tenets of limiting personal possessions. So this Jainism has been advocating this, that you must limit your personal possessions, you must limit your personal consumption. And this is the lifestyle, you know, which you must have. And therefore, if you have a Jain lifestyle, you overcome almost all problems of environment, you know. The planet can be saved from disaster by controlling greed, particularly by wealthier countries, and restoring to simple lifestyle without compromising on personal comforts, you know. We are not denying that, you know, you should not have personal comforts, but the consumption pattern, you know, the luxuries, you know, on which we are spending a lot, had to be controlled. The disaster consequences of consumption manifest in greenhouse effect, climate change, shortage of water, food, etc., pollution, degradation of environment. Doctrine of celibacy is again important for social environment, you know. Sex is cause of many crimes of murder, loot, harassment, suicides, and the vow of celibacy is important for social harmony. So celibacy helps us a lot in having good social environment. Vegetarianism, again, very important aspect, you know, and all Jains are ordained to be vegetarian. Vegetarianism is very beneficial for environmental protection, as non-vegetarian takes almost 10 times more than a vegetarian and puts much more pressure on the environment. Animals eat vegetation or plant food and utilize 90% of the calorie intake for their metabolism and store only 10% as meat, which we take from that and we eat, you know, people eat. So the 90% is going only for the maintenance of the animals. Thus, a non-vegetarian gets indirectly only 10% of the vegetation consumed by animals or birds, whose meat he consumes, and thus requires 10 times more vegetation, land, water, manure, than directly consuming vegetation, you know. So this is a very inefficient way of getting food. Apart from religious considerations, vegetarianism has ecological and economical dimensions. Damage done to the economy on account of producing animal food or nourishing the meat eating habits is irreparable. A large chunk of food grains is set aside for forced breeding of livestock for the purpose of producing animal food. For instance, the livestock in US consumes 80% of soya and 90% of corn produced in the country. And in the United Kingdom, 90% of the agricultural land is used to produce feed for livestock. See the figures. And India also, an estimated 40 million tons of food grains are consumed by the poultry and animal rearing exercises for the meat industry. The industry in return produces 4 million tons of meat and eggs, which meets a part of the food requirement of 40 million people only. Otherwise, this 40 million tons of food grains could have met full requirement of 400 million people, 10 times more. So you now decide which is the better way. Reduction in medical expenses, increase in exports, production of dung manure, and hence reduction in fertilizer bill, etc., would be additional benefits of vegetarianism. This is in respect to India. By reduced use of chemical fertilizers, the soil will be saved of loss in fertility and the consumers will be saved of poisonous effect of chemicals. Very important point. Conservation of groundwater is another important aspect. Water is a scarcity nowadays, we know. And it connects with food habits. So there is a relation between the water and food habit. According to the Productivity Council of California, USA, the quantity of water required for the manufacture of 1 kilogram of the following commodities is given here. So you take the commodity figure and the water required. Tomatoes require only 90 liters of water per kg of tomato. You know. Potatoes 90, wheat 100. Carrots 125, apples 190, oranges 240, grapes 250, milk 520. Now look at the figures. Eggs 2000, chickens 3200, pork 4800, meat 10,000. Look at the enormous water requirement for non-veg food. The hectic rate at which animals are slaughtered for the purpose of producing meat, it is only a matter of time that drinking water becomes the scarcest commodity on earth, you know. You are wasting water on producing non-vegetarian food. Then there is a doctrine of sustainability. There is unanimity that sustainability should be the primary consideration in every program. Indiscriminate consumerism and sustainability are not compatible with each other. There are clear warnings that at present rate of consumption, most of the natural resources will be will not last long and will be totally exhausted within next 100 to 200 years. Water is the most important natural resource and is being consumed many times more than its replenishment and renewable capacity. It is because of the non-vegetarian food, remember. Greenhouse effects and climate change are also a result of rising consumption level. To avoid eventual catastrophe, it is necessary to reduce consumption level within the carrying capacity of natural resources. And we must all try for that. Enlightened Jain thinkers have emphasized on keeping consumption levels at minimum to ensure sustainability. So this sustainability and environmental protection and preventing environment being polluted and degradation is inbuilt in the Jain doctrines and principles, you know. So now we can feel and appreciate, you know, how useful is Jain philosophy, how useful is Jain practices, you know. That helps you, your fellow beings, the other life forms, and try have a good environment, good society. Thank you.